first item is tab one, page one, to approve the minutes of October 24th. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Does anyone wish to make comments at this time from the public?
No one signed up.
All right, next we need to consider the audit, and Shannon Daniels is going to take us through a handout from the audit process.
Okay, thank you.
If I might, real quick, the audit committee was Kendall, Steve, and Gerald. So they have comments as well, except Shannon.
Yes, I'll just hit the highlight. The most important, one of the most important things is that we got a clean opinion, so that's the highest assurance that they can give us on our statement. As John mentioned, the audit committee did meet this morning with the auditors, and everything went well. The financials are sound, the controls are good. You did get this a little bit early on yesterday. If you had a chance to look through it, if you have questions, I'd be happy to answer those. Otherwise, if someone from the audit committee wants to make a statement or a comment.
I would just add one thing, which is we did have an executive session where we asked management to be excused from the room, and we're pleased to report that there were no additional matters that the auditors felt compelled to bring to our attention. So, and everything, there were no disagreements with management, so we were very satisfied with it and recommended it to the board for approval.
Is there a second?
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. Our next item is approve and authorize the filing of the district's annual report. Page two, or tab two, page four.
Every year at this time, we submit an annual report to the MS system, which is the Electronic Municipal Market Access System for the Municipal Securities Rulemaking Board. And this is part of our continuing disclosure obligation as an issuer of municipal securities. And so that people who are either owners of our bonds or might be interested in buying them have a central place to go to get updated financial information on the district. And the report is here in front of you, starting on pages 4 and 5, and then you see the supporting documents that you're also authorizing us to send, which are the, and this map that the audit's been approved, that'll change to audited general purpose financial statements, page 6, and then a brief update regarding Hurricane Harvey, which is exhibit B on the following page, and that is the annual report.
We have to have a motion.
And the motion authorizes us to submit it.
Yes. So I'd like to request a motion to approve the district's annual report and authorize filing of the same in accordance with district's continuing disclosure of information agreement as required by SEC Rule 15C2-12 after any discussion. Anybody want to make that motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
And is there any discussion or questions before we vote? All those in favor? Okay, motion carries. Next item, review and consider approval of petitions from the Hudson Brothers Real Estate and Palmetto Linden LP to the Harris County Improvement District Number 1 and the City of Houston for the annexation of land into the district.
I'm going to jump in front of Jessica here at this moment because I want to give you a little bit of a story behind this. This is a map of Harris County Improvement District Number 1. This being Westheimer, Post Oak Boulevard, etc. As you can see, the district does take in the Uptown Park area, and what it doesn't take in is the little highlighted properties here that are shown there. I want to jump ahead. This is not terribly clear, but this is the TERS boundaries. And so here is Uptown Park Boulevard. This is Post Oak Lane. This is North and South Winden. And so what is important to note here that the TERS covers this area, but the management district doesn't. And the property owners in this area is illustrated here, designed to be brought into the management district to Harris County Improvement District Number 1. And that will sort of go along with our theme of keeping areas covered by the TERS also covered by the management district. It allows us to do that. And then kind of the motivation for all of that is that we are going to actually make some road improvements on Post Oak Lane, new signalized intersection. And we sort of have a, I'm taking you back to June or so when the board took action, sort of having a hand-holding here that says that the properties in the area will dedicate right-of-way for the widening of the roadway. And then they will also agree to be brought into the district. Or in the case of the condominium of the Belle Fiore, enter into a development agreement to pay their fair share of improvements. And then the district itself would bid, design and bid the improvements. And so what we're about to, what Jessica and Stephen are about to talk about is the portion of this of bringing those property into the management district. Okay, sort of a roadmap of where we are. Started this in June, and here we find ourselves in December trying to get the very last of all the steps.
Great summary. What I've got today for you all to approve, I've received the executed petitions from Hudson Brothers, who's the owner of about 13 acres. That's the... There you go. A petition for annexation from Hudson Brothers, and then a petition for annexation from Palmetto. For those of you who haven't gone through this process before, it's two steps. We receive the petitions, and together with the landowners, we petition the City of Houston for their consent. I'm anticipating that's going to take a number of months, especially since we're submitting this right at the holiday time. Once we have the city's consent, we'll come back to the board, and you will adopt your order adding land, and that will be the official action that adds this into your district boundaries, and they will be subject to your tax levy.
Any questions or discussion?
Is there any land in the dotted land that we would be, and I'm saying that's not already in the TERS?
No. I think all of that is in the TERS.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Where will the new signalized intersection be?
Robert will cover that in just a moment, but we'll actually be in the middle. Robert, is that correct? We'll be here?
Correct. Halfway between the two windows.
The property owner here, which is known as the McNair Group, planned development here. And this road would be access to that, but it would also be a big asset access that it will slow traffic down on Post Oak Lane. Plus, some of these properties can go through here and actually get out on the road with it.
If there's no other discussion, I'd like to request a motion to approve the annexation. Do we have a motion?
Do you have questions?
No question. Nobody's got a motion. Is there a second? All those in approval? Okay, motion approved. Next item is to consider authorizing the staff to award contract for improvements to the South Post Oak Lane, tab 3, page 49. Robert, you're up.
In the area we're talking from is from South Windham to Tilbury, with North Windham being here, Largemont being here, and the Belforte here property that was just annexed is here, going this direction. And it started as a traffic signal question, how to get better access. And you'll notice that every street is offset. There is no street aligning to get a four-way stop. So this has been an issue with the city of Houston for some time, because there has been petitions from these people how to get back out on the street when there's when you start off from here and you race to the next signal. So a traffic signal will provide some improvement on accessibility to Post Oak Lane from both sides of the street. So the question is where to put it, and they dedicated enough room on this side of the roadway to be able to widen it from a four lane to a five lane to create a center lane, which is the left turn storage for northbound and southbound, to get into their property and get into the west side of Post Oak.
I think you have some drawings that will show.
So it's a signalized intersection. It's the widening. We're not going to repave the existing. It's only about 15 years old or so, and it's in pretty good shape. And so it's just the widening. We need a 10-foot easement from most of the property. From the Belaforte, we could do with 5 because we're angling at that point, not having a full depth increase. This is the north looking this way. Condominiums here. The 5-foot acquisition is here, and we're starting to widen right about here to get enough room to put the signal in here and then bring it back down and connect over here. Two approaches to the windings are approved so that we can have from a 2-lane to we have at least 3 lanes, maybe 4 lanes, access into Post Oak Lane. To do this, the biggest part of the project was to create the opportunity to widen. Get the widening, we had to do the utility relocations. This is South North Windon, South Windon, and this is the project. Utility costs are really higher than the construction cost, because to get all the poles vacated and moved over, we had to build $2 million. This was our estimate, $2 million worth of electrical ducts underground for just center point. Another 400 for AT&T and the others. So the construction utility relocation is 2.4. We also had $1 million worth of costs with terms and conditions to the different private utilities to bring them, to have them come out and pull the wires from overhead and put them underground. So this is non-construction work. So we had $3.4 million worth of work to do, and about $1.7 million for our estimate. $5.1 million for the project. We got 7 bids. We got a real good bid in 3.48 with Harper Brothers. Harper Brothers is the contractor doing the north side. They also did Hollyhurst for us, or working on Hollyhurst. Hollyhurst is a similar project, a lot of wire utility relocations, a lot of ductwork involved. So they're our contractor, a low bid for this, and we would recommend award contract them. So, as it turns out, the construction costs for the wire utility, or everything except for pulling the wire utility, is 3.5, and our total cost is still estimated 4.5 instead of 5.1. So, project came in good. And that's it.
So, Mr. Chairman,
I'll go back.
Yeah.
You got a question?
No.
How long is that stretch there, Robert?
It is. Not very long. I'm less than a mile.
Three quarters, maybe a little less.
I'd have to look at the plans. You got that in?
Yeah.
Is
there
plans?
No, sir.
Go ahead.
Do they have plans for the property?
We have seen 2 plans. One would be rendering for an office on this side of the signal, and there's another residential product on this side. We haven't seen anything for the interior yet. And this is the old Mazraff's restaurant. They currently do catering still out of it, and it would still survive after the construction.
It's interesting, sort of the history of all that. If you've been on the board, you know that we've worked for years, talked about improving North and South Windon, brought into the TERS. We've actually entered in and done development agreements, put some utilities in this. Really, with McNair's group sort of leading the way, getting works out. We've all long needed a signalized intersection. We worked for years to try and get the city to agree to it, et cetera. And by getting them to dedicate some additional right-of-way, it allows us to do it, and we think we'll make driving up and down Plus Oak Lane a heck of a lot safer.
According to my gadget, that's 0.2 miles. The stoplight intersection signaling will only be at Longmont and Post Oak Lane, nowhere else? Or are there signals at Wyndon?
There's no signal at Wyndon. The only signal will be at the Largemont.
Longmont?
No, Longmont.
Okay. And did you show us something that shows the signal, or is it just lanes on Wyndon?
Back up, Robert, can you put back your drawing up?
By the way, I don't know what gizmo you're using, but it didn't show all the way from this point, that point on that diagram. Signal is here, Wyndon's there, Belforte, the condos are here. So this provides at least breaks in traffic southbound that can be used to get out. Similar here, and to get in here, it'll break northbound to get in here from this way. So it does provide some access improvements for all the properties.
I think it's likely that as development occurs, it's sort of like Four Oaks Drive. It's a private drive that tends to be used by the community. This may be a point of access for some of the residential development as well.
Okay, so do we have more questions? Go ahead.
You referenced our earlier meeting in the summer, maybe the earlier one. The four, I guess it's 3.4 plus a million, 4.5. That money was budgeted where in our overall?
It's budgeted two places. The management district has sold bonds to do this, and the TERS has agreed to pay the debt on these bonds. And so that's.
So it's contemplated in both capital plans?
Yes.
Yes.
So, again, good bids, and we're recommending the award to Harper Brothers Construction at $3.485 million. I will say that your award today would be ultimately on the contingent upon the finalization of all these moving parts here of the dedication of right-of-way. I think we're there. I'm looking, leaning over to Jessica.
Two of the three easements are in.
And Del Fiore is entering into a development agreement, which they're approving December 20th, which will pay us for their portion of the utility. Okay?
So, Steve, we want a motion authorizing the ability to award a contract to one of those, or are we just picking the top?
We want to award to the low bidder, and that's going to be contingent on receipt of dedicated right-of-way easements from all of the participants in a signed development agreement with Del Fiore.
So it looks like Harper's, but that might change without coming back?
We're confident that Harper's a low bidder, everybody, right?
Yes, the bid is fine. It's the contingencies on the participants get their right-of-way and funding arranged.
Just a question is, if we do award them, is there a time limit? I mean, there a time in which they have to hold that contract price?
There's a time limit on that.
It's 60 days, but the contract is working with us right now, currently under contract. And I don't believe there would be any problem holding their price. Should there be any delay, but we met with the Belforte, and they're going to take action on the point.
We met with the executive committee of their board 2 days ago.
Yeah.
And we answered all their questions, I think, and they were giving us, they thought they would have no problems that would be approved.
So we anticipate having all the decision provisions wrapped up by December
20th. Okay. Okay, so if there's no more discussion, do we have a motion to approve the motion or the authorization found on page 49?
Motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, motion carries. Next item is holiday seasonal obelisks.
All right, so I realize that two of you were not in the board meeting, and my goodness, August, I believe it was, when we went over this. So I have that presentation in behind me, and I can get into that if we have to. But I'm going to give you a pretty quick summary, but I'm more than happy to answer any questions you might have. Beginning, my goodness, very first year in 1986, we actually got into doing the Uptown Holiday Project, where we lined Post Oak Boulevard with trees. It was an instant success, and we have continued that up until this year. If the first 2 or 3 years we actually used trees, we went down and cut down out of the forest, brought to Houston and put lights on them. And then somewhere around 1989-90, we actually converted over to a fake tree. And those trees have served us well. I don't know if any of you have been out here during the holidays, but it really seems like there's something missing. We tried to go back in and do a little bit of lighting in some of the oak trees that are along the boulevard, but it's pretty, it's kind of, looks like we're missing something. That really led us to say, what can we do about the holiday program, which Uptown Houston is really known for? And we did a lot of research into possibilities. The baseline, I would tell you that bids that we got in, or I would say costs that we got in working with contractors to even replicate those trees that we had from San Felipe to Westheimer would have estimated the cost of something about $3 million to do the entire boulevard. And so that's where we began. And our previous presentation, I took us through sort of the history of how this design evolved. But what we ended up with is a elliptical spiral helix. And they're 18 feet tall. These are extruded. I wouldn't actually say extruded. It is tubular form, stainless steel pipe with a brush finish. Instead of being like our stainless steel where it's polished, and the polished mirror finish literally eats light, it doesn't reflect a lot of light in the evening. This brush finish, you can see an example here in a moment, really does catch light and really works for light that's shown onto it. There's a very large light here in the base, and that casts a light up, and it has the ability to change colors, and I have a short video I can show. Then at the intersection of each one of these, there's a light in the inside, on both the outside and the inside, and in between then there's a form of mini lamp, almost like a strobe. And so we went through a process where we worked with three different groups trying to develop a prototype, seeing what was feasible, how to do it. Working with Houston pipe vendors here locally, they are actually the ones that bent our stainless steel arches back in the early 90s. And they actually formed this using aluminum tubing and heat. It was one thing we learned is that you probably wouldn't want to do it that way. Certainly you couldn't maintain any consistency. It was just too slow, and the quality wasn't enough. What we found, there's a machine that essentially forms this pipe, not in trees per day, but inches of pipe per second. It's a computer control. It continuously bends this pipe, and we can end up with something. I think I have a photograph here in a minute. So we end up with, we developed a prototype reflected here in these drawings. These were also the drawings that we used in the bid. This is a prototype that was done using the machine, and that gives you some sense of scale. This is inch and a quarter tubing versus an inch and a half, but it gives you some idea of what it actually looked like. Now, this is that same one
And here is the light that's shining up, and you see how it catches and reflects that light. It really does do that. And then you can see this. I have a very short video. I thought I did. Where? Right here? Nope. Okay, let me tell you. With me, 260 of these as currently envisioned. And the reason why is given the big median that we have in the middle of Post Oak Boulevard, we put them on the sidewalk side, and then where possible, we would put them every 80 feet, even on the median. And so you would have essentially four rows of trees, but you would be driving down an experienced sort of trees on both sides of it. If you didn't do the median, you really couldn't, you wouldn't get that feel. These are 80 feet on center, both on the sidewalk and median side, and they would run from the West Loop all the way down to Richmond, about 10,000 feet. This is a short little video clip of how this works. You can see how this changes here. You get 16 million different views of color. You can see the little lights here in the middle of the bronze wall working with each one of these lights.
Cost. And so in the end,
I think this area is known for what we do on holidays. It seems like we're missing something today. This is something that you have budgeted at $3.5 million. I think this is the best bid we're going to get with people who can produce this. And it is our request that you authorize us to, you award and us to negotiate a contract not to exceed $3,850,000. And I'd be glad to try to answer any questions you have.
Do we have a feel for the likely casualty rate? Do we have a lot of wayward cars going into
out there now? We never lost a Christmas tree due to a car hitting it. But these are going to be a little bit, everything else in the world has been hit with the Christmas trees.
Might be the stainless steel illumination that we have out there in the city. And I think once every 2 years we lose one.
Okay.
So it's a major wreck.
Less than one a year.
Yeah.
Okay.
The median poles get hit more than kind of the big poles, at intersections.
Bigger targets.
Closer to the center of the target.
So I assume the Ballister Group was the group that designed the poles?
Yeah.
That's the only company that would bid on.
The issue here is that the machine to produce this in an economical way with the level of performance, standard, and quality is a pretty big investment. And don't know all the story myself, but done a little bit of research on it. But basically, they're made in Japan. They sell something like 12 a year. This is probably a $250,000 machine in itself to produce this. And there is not available capacity. I mean, Houston Pipe Benders was trying to find an existing machine to produce this rather than getting in line to get the machine.
So are we buying the machine or are we asking our low bidder?
The low bidder buys it. We're going to hold a lead on it, though, is kind of our performance.
I'm curious, what's the machine cost?
Yeah,
I think it's something on a $500,000 level.
Makes sense to buy the machine and then bid the part of the project. So you have the machine that, that's what's keeping it from getting competitive bids.
I think the keeping us getting competitive bids. I think we had a lot of competition. At the end, they chose not to go forward because perhaps they didn't want to buy the machine. It really means if you buy the machine, you're going to be in that business. And what do they see as additional business? So that might have been the reason we didn't get a bid, because of that reason. This is a real artisan project. There's a lot of handwork, if you had a machine, you could bend the tube, but I don't know if you could do all the other pieces, put it together, etc. And so I do think that we're buying, I want to push it, not call it art, but I'll say artisan fabrication. And this firm that we discovered basically does that. That is what they do. Became interested in the project after we contacted them, talked to them, and they became interested in it. And that's who really took off and produced that well-executed prototype. So, Greg, I think what I just told you, that we tried to be as competitive as possible and meet that need, but we're also trying to buy, I'm going to push it a little bit, art here, and it's not everybody that could do it. So,
incremental cost over the useful life.
I think that this will be, these structures I think will the 20, 30-year structures, probably long. Long after anybody sitting at the table here today is probably making decisions. Yes, sir.
Just one other question. I think the structures probably will last, assuming Kendall doesn't get them. But can the lights and wiring be changed out easily when they become obsolete?
Yes. John, key word, I don't think you and I could do it.
No.
Because you used the word easy. But it is so that if we have a problem, can it be repaired? Can the light be repaired? And the answer is yes. Basically, you have wiring harnesses that are pulled through the pipe and pulled out. And so I think the answer is yes.
One other question.
Yes, sir.
Those things do a lot of things, apparently. Are we hiring a software engineer and a computer programmer, or are they more user-friendly than that?
They are not more user-friendly than that. They will do a certain thing just sitting there. But a part of our pylons, our headlights, as well as this, part of our budget is programming. So that it will do some very interesting things. So they will become a piece of art up and down the board. Okay.
So do we have a motion to approve up to $3.85 million for 260 elliptical HELOC obelisk trees? Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. And we're a little bit over time. Should we have a very quick update on the Boulevard Memorial Park and green space?
I think we could keep that short for Post-Up Boulevard. Robert could add anything you want to. I'm staying in constant contact with you as you call in to tell us how to improve traffic operations. But I will say that our contractors met their schedule. In fact, did the piece from Westheimer to San Felipe. Northbound was completed early. We will have all six new lanes of concrete north of San Felipe finished by the end of this month. And come January, we will start back in earnest, and we'll be working on the northbound traffic between San Felipe and Westheimer, as well as southbound. And that is at the point, Greg, that we will be beginning that work south of Westheimer and making some pretty big changes in that area. But I will not force Robert to say it here, but he says given the progress the contractors have made, he's feeling much more secure about Thanksgiving of 2019. If you're up on the North End Boulevard, you'll see we're planting trees. We will soon begin.
18.
What did I just say?
18.
So staff, you caught it, and the board was okay with it. 18, thank you. Christmas trees by 19.
Will the trees in the median be the same height as the ones on the sidewalk?
They're going to be, they are the same grove of trees, so the answer is yes. They might actually look a little taller because we're planting them a little differently. The sidewalk trees, actually, the head of the crown or the top of the crown is a few inches beneath the sidewalk for air and for growing. And the trees that will be in the 4-foot strip and in the medians will be planted higher. So they actually may look a little bit taller, but they're all the same brothers and sisters.
And the lights will be pulled out. The
Christmas trees will be in between the 40-foot trees on center, and the Christmas trees will be 80 feet on center. And then, if that works out, we can show you the drawing.
Any other questions about the updates, Memorial Park?
No real changes or new
any natural grasses and such.
Great, we're adjourned. Thank you all very much.